Christ came. Good morning. It's so wonderful to see everybody. Will you stand up and join me? We're gonna raise a hallelujah, y'all. I'll raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I'll raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I'll raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I'll raise a hallelujah, 'cause heaven's come to fight for me, yeah.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm, louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise, death is defeated, the King is alive.
I raise a hallelujah
with everything inside of me.
Come on. I raise a hallelujah. I will watch the darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah in the middle of the mystery. I'll raise a hallelujah. Fear you lost your hold on me. Hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise, 'cause death is defeated, the King is alive. Oh, yeah. Woo! Come on. We're gonna sing, y'all.
King is alive. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the from the ashes, hope will arise. For death is defeated, the King is alive. I say the hallelujah.
Come on, raise it, yeah.
I raise a hallelujah.
Oh, you gotta roll now.
I raise a hallelujah.
You feel it?
And I would like to welcome you to Ignite this morning. And I'm thrilled to be leading in worship with you this morning with Adia, Lisa, Andrea, Derek, and Sean, and Alex. Ignite, it welcomes all. No matter how you identify yourself or others identify you, you are welcome here. Ignite preaches good news for all, not bad news for some. So please remain standing. And as we go into our next song, it's called Peace. I think we all could use some peace. For me, I think of peace as one of the greatest gifts that God has given us, and it's the Holy Spirit. So let His Holy Spirit and peace wash over you this morning.
When my mind is like a battlefield, and my heart is overcome by fear, and hope seems like a ship that's lost at sea, my enemies on every side, and I'm tempted to run and hide, your gentle whisper reaches out to me. Peace holds me when I'm broken. Sweet peace that passes understanding. When the whole wide world is crashing down, I fall to my knees and breathe. Fall to my knees. I remember who you are. You're the God who's never far. So I will not be afraid. God, you always keep me safe in your arms. I remember who you are. You're the God who's never far away. So I will not be afraid. God, God, you always keep me safe.
I just want to greet everyone. I'm going to take a moment to just say hello. And it's so nice to be here with this Ignite community. Please take this moment. Please greet someone you have not met before. And if you haven't seen in a while this morning, say, Happy New Year. Sorry. It's small print.
Because you know this song so well, but it's time for our children's moment. I love it. How are you? Good? Having a good morning? Yeah. Are you freezing? No? You are, you're not. I'm a little cold, but it feels so nice out. So I have kind of a trivia question that you guys can maybe think about, maybe know the answer. So other than humans, this is a living thing that's talked about in the Bible the most. Can you think of what it might be? Do you want a hint?
Yeah.
It's a type of something that grows from, it's a plant. Any ideas? No. Grapes? It does do grow from the ground, but it's not grapes. It's something else. But that's a really good guess. We talk about grapes and wine in the vineyard a lot. The fig tree. Oh, the palm branches. That is very close, right? A bush, yes, we talk about those a lot. And palm branches. What did you say, Kira? A tree? Kira, you're right, it's trees. That's awesome. So in one of the versions, we know that trees are mentioned like 293 times in the Bible. That's a lot, right? So they must be pretty important. Why do you think we might mention trees so much in the Bible? Yeah, Benjamin?
Because of the fruit and giving and stuff?
Yep, that's a great reason. What do you think, Claire?
Because of air and we breathe.
Yeah, because they're so important to life. We breathe the air. Yeah, Zoe? Same thing. And the other thing, too, is, you know, like all plants, they provide for us if we do what with them? If we use them correctly and take care of them correctly. So the same way that we think about trees especially and plants, we have to think about kind of our faith in the same way and do things to take care of our faith. So what are some things that we do to take care of our faith? Hugs is a good way to take care of our faith, right? What else? Can you think of things that you do that help your faith grow? What did you whisper? Oh, that too, yeah. What do we do to take care of trees? We water them, right? So what's a way that we can give them sunlight? So then the sun does, yeah. So what are ways that we can, like, give water and light to our faith? What are things that we can do to take care of it? Practice it. What's one way to practice it? Reading the Bible is a great thing. What else? Praying is a great thing. What about just coming to church on Sunday? And Sunday school is a great way. And even here in this community, sometimes it's just seeing members of our community and saying hello is a great way to do that. Or taking communion is a great way. So these are all ways that we can care for one another. And when we care for one another in our community, we're caring for our faith too. So friends, let's pray together. You can repeat after me. Good morning, Jesus. Thank you for today, for the sunshine. Thank you for loving us and always being there for us whenever we need to talk to you. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, we can head to Sunday school or back to class.
So I am going to be sharing with you the scripture reading for today, Matthew 5, 3 through 5. Happy are people who are hopeless, because the kingdom of heaven is theirs. Happy are people who grieve, because they will be made glad. Happy are people who are humble, because they will inherit the earth. God's word for God's people. Thanks be to God.
Moments so dear, 525,600 minutes.
525,600 minutes, 525,000 moments to plan, 525,600 minutes. Oh, how do you measure the life of a woman or man? In truth that she learned, old times that he cried, in bridges he burned, all the way that she died.
It's time now to sing them, though the story never ends.
It's time to celebrate, remember the year and the life of a friend. Remember the love, oh, you got to remember the love. You know that love, it is a gift from up above. Share love, give love, spread it.
Measure love.
This is where I just want to sit for a minute and just kind of be, because you've just gifted us, both of you. You've just gifted us with Spirit and Christ and the presence of God in you, welling up and flowing out. And I am a thirsty man, and I have been sitting in a stream of water, and I thank you for that. Thank you, thank you. I love the fact that after church last week, some of you caught my elbow and said, now wait a minute, I didn't know the Greek said, and you asked me questions about what I had said, and all this week I kept having people, I just love being part of a church that does not accept something as true just because the pastor said it. I love that. That's a hallmark of a healthy congregation. Biblical scholarship is a discipline. And like every other discipline, there are arguments and positions and discoveries being made and peer review articles being written. And then there's responses and arguments back. And I have been downright gleeful this week at the number of people in this church who are engaging in questioning and wondering. And in coming weeks, you're going to begin to see how I do my work, the process that I learned for engaging biblical scholarship, and how that process and the discoveries it brings informs my discipleship. My hope is that it will inform your discipleship too. And one of the questions that kept coming this week was people who said, I thought Jesus only spoke Aramaic. And it's true, he did speak Aramaic. Well, we'll get to that in a minute. There is an argument among biblical scholars, very definitely an argument, and I have taken a position. You don't have to agree with me. That's not the kind of church this is. That would be a cult. I'm not interested in leading a cult. We have to inform one another. We have to say we don't agree on everything, and that's okay. So here's how I think about this. Yes, absolutely, Jesus spoke Aramaic. It's the language of his village, certainly. He spoke it on the cross. He said, Lama sabachthani. And but interesting, I don't know if you've noticed this, anytime Jesus speaks Aramaic in the gospel, it's italicized, like This is special. We should make note of this. So definitely Jesus spoke Aramaic, although the fact that it's special or set apart should tell us something, but I'm not exactly sure what. Luke 4 also tells us that Jesus is in his hometown, and he's in the worshiping community, and they invite him to come forward and read scripture. He reads from the Old Testament prophet Isaiah. So this tells us that Jesus also read and spoke Hebrew. And then a little bit later in the Gospels, he also conversed, he has an argument with a Syrophoenician woman who would have spoken Phoenician. So we're understanding that Jesus was a common man of his age. Israel was definitely the crossroads of commerce in the known world, and it was very common that most people who wanted to do any business other than in the local, I mean, you could have one language if you never left your home village. That's fine. But if you wanted to be engaging in business with someone who was from out of country, or when you were out of country, you had to speak at least a little bit of several languages. And of the languages that are listed, only Greek is accepted in official circles. There's also Latin. Latin was spoken, but Latin is more of a governmental, official language. It's not, if anybody took Latin, it's not really a conversational language. It's it impresses you, but that's about it. Greek, if you do a search online about languages spoken in the Roman Empire, you would find Greek in that list. And And this is a very large Roman Empire. It was only, you might remember, it was only about 65 years before the birth of Jesus that the Romans came to power in Israel by driving out the Greeks who had been there for over 300 years. Somebody after the first service came out and said, you know what, I go to India on business, and in India they speak English because the English occupied for just over 100 years. So we can think about the effect of being occupied by the Greeks for 300 years. So my position, my argument, is that Jesus spoke Greek, and he spoke it well. We also know that he spoke it well enough at his trial to verbally spar with Pilate. And he mocks Pilate back a little bit. But that's my position. So, and I could be wrong. And isn't it fun to wonder? And isn't it fun to be part of a church where we might not agree on everything, but we revel in what we teach one another from different points of view? So I'm going to hold that Jesus spoke Greek. What we know is that we have received the New Testament in Greek, and so we are looking at Jesus' first public sermon, which comes to us in Greek. And what do we know? Well, we know a few things. The first thing we know, Jesus is speaking this sermon to a crowd of people, inviting us to a different way of living. We know that Jesus is sharing his call to ministry, defining his ministry, revealing the reason for his presence among people like you and like me, telling what is deserving of his attention, telling what is deserving of our attention, even to the point of giving his life. And then last week we arrived at his first word, Makarios. It's a two-step process in the royal court. Makarios begins when the king and the queen, or the queen, look on you. You've come in. You're not worthy. It's a gift that you're there.
You don't expect the approval of the king because you've been poisoned by the world. You've been crushed by the world. You've been subject to the world. The world always has a way of defining you on its own terms. The king looks on you, approves, confers on you value and blessing and recognition, the status of being favored. That's the first movement of Makarios. The second movement of Makarios is in us. We came in the presence of the king knowing that I don't measure up. The king trusted me and I blew it. The king's going to take one look at me and go, nope, going to be rejection. And you crouching and kind of bracing for that rejection to go. But we receive approval. We receive the thumbs up. We receive the conferring. And we gasp. It's a surprise. Restoration of our identity. And we stand, when we breathe deep, we always stand a little higher. We rise, elongating into our full stature. Makarios is God's declaration, God's restoration of your identity, your worth. This is what we know so far, and we've only gotten through Jesus' first word. Not only do I hold that Jesus spoke Greek, but I also hold that Jesus was brilliant. And not just shiny bright like we see in the paintings from that era. I'm talking here. He's got it going on from here up. Watch how he puts words together. The first beatitude connects back to Makarios. Remember, the first word is Makarios, coming, crushed and broken into the presence of the king. The first beatitude, Jesus says, blessed are the poor in spirit. Poor in spirit, the Greek is ptochoi to nomadic. Poor in spirit. Ptochoi means, you ready for this? Crouched and coward. Crushed by the world. Sounds familiar. And then pneumati, spirit, is our connection to God, our definition of who we are. So poor in spirit, ptochoi to pneumatic, would mean the world has gotten their hands on us. The world has been working on us, shaking us loose from our moorings to God, distracted us and isolated us and tried to redefine us in its own terms, intimidated us. That's what poor in spirit, ptochoi to pneumatic, means. Jesus began with this blessing, Makarios. The fix is in the first word. You follow that? He starts with the resolution, and then he states the problem, and then he says some other things. But the fix is in the first word, Makarios, in the presence of your king, you who have been crushed by the world to the point where you have lost your connection with God. In the presence of the king, the poor in spirit are restored. And then he goes on to say, for theirs is the kingdom. The Greek here is, got a word, basileia. Basileia simply means to have a king and to be the subject of that king, faithful to that king, to be ruled by your king, to walk in the way of the king, to live as a representative of the king. We're being invited to give some thought to how freeing it is to live as a representative of our king. We don't have to wonder anymore how we should respond to the everything that happens around us in the world, everything that comes our way. We don't have to wonder, how can I possibly go on? I don't know who I am in the midst of these struggles. Yeah, you do. Basilia, you're the subject of the king. We follow the way of the king. We are the property of the king. We come into the presence of the king. Makarios reconnects us to the king. This is the way of the kingdom, and we're walking. Likewise, the second beatitude, Makarios, is Jesus' first word. Blessed are those who mourn. We've got a word. The word is pentounce. Pentounce means what grief means in English. It's a really good translation, but the stress here is on not, oh, I'm grieving. It's, I'm grieving, I can't talk. It's manifest grief that has taken up residence in us. It's grief so severe that it's taken over the identity of us. Grief has this effect. It unclasps our connections to all forms of identity that we've ever had. It overflows us with a fog. It sets us adrift in that fog, and we're wander paddling, trying to find our way, lost in, I don't know who I am anymore, is a common word for someone who's grieving. Jesus began this blessing with Makarios. Remember, the fix is in the first word. In the presence of our King, those mourning find reconnection, find mooring, find identity. And then he goes on to say, they shall be comforted. Yes, having your identity restored is comforting. And then we've got another word, and I can't pronounce this one. Parakalelo, I think is how we say that. Parakalia, I'm not, again, I can't pronounce this word. We don't have to, we're not speaking Greek here. We're interpreting Greek. So often grieving is intensified by the feeling that we need to get somewhere we are not. We're grieving and we think, well, I've got to get over this. I've got to get through this. I really should get myself together, is something that people grieving often say. Like we've been taught there are stages of grief, and while I'm to stage 3, that's nonsense. We feel like that should be the way it is, so we make it that way, but grief doesn't work that way. And this text, that word that I can't pronounce, is that connection. God knows who you are, and God comforts you by connecting to you. That's what that word means. It's that reconnecting to God. God's presence does not resolve our grief. God's presence grounds us and reminds us who we are and reminds us whose we are. And now we come to the third beatitude, verse 5, blessed, Makarios, are the meek. Now, we've received the word meek into English, and it means what we think it means in English, meek. It means mild and humble and gentle and modest. And we didn't get the real meaning from the Greek. That's not what the word means. It does, but that's not really the meaning of it in Greek. In Greek, the word is praus. Praus means under control, defined by the better way of a master. Praus. And so, yes, when we're not in control, when we're feeling less, praus means that we are mild and gentle and modest, and we don't have to bluster up and pretend and make ourselves be something. We're not asserting our own identity. We don't have to do that. We can be meek. It does not diminish our value. That's kind of half of the definition of prowse. Prowse means being under control, defined by the master. Equally, when you're strong, when you're in a position of strength, when you're in a position of power, especially when that's power over someone else. This is an image out of the royal stable. That comes with prowse. That's where the word comes from. It's out of the royal stable, where war horses are trained to be strong and under control in battle. Triumph for a war horse comes through the connection between the rider and the horse. And this beautiful, strong, pride-filled horse is trained to be in submission of their whole strength, their whole being, to the way of the master. And the horse, its strength, becomes an extension of its master's intent. Just the touch of the master's knee on the horse's shoulder is enough. And the horse walks in the way of the master, using its strength and presence to part the crowd without knocking people down, without stepping on or crushing those who are in front, unless that's the will of the master on the battlefield. The horse walks the way of the master, gentle in the face of threat, even in the face of death. And the message for us is we can be quite strong. We can assert strong identities under control of the master, our master. And Jesus began this blessing with Makarios. The fix is in the first word. In the presence of your king, you can dare to submit what comes naturally to you to the way of the king. We learn the way of the king. We become extensions of our master. And then he says, they will inherit the earth. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. We got a word for this. Kleronomeo. It means that you will receive by inheritance that which others have spent their life trying to get by conquering. Identity and value and approval and blessing, everything you need in this world will be given to you as you need it. What do we know? We're noticing that Jesus, the first thing we know is that we're noticing that Jesus is using images of the royal court. We need to pay attention to that. It's important. It will come back. We'll come back to that. We'll learn more as we go on. The second thing we know this crowd. We are being invited to contemplate and wander and wonder about. We're being invited to walk in a way that is not our way. We're being invited to walk in a way that doesn't come to us naturally. It is a difficult way. And the third thing we know is that we're going to talk more about this next week.
us your ways.
Teach us to give. Teach us to
as we come into our time of offering, Lord, we ask that you teach us how to give. We know giving is a spiritual act. And if you are a member or this is your church home, we ask that you give either using the basket in the back or online at pvmc.org/give.
Every week here at Ignite, we come to the communion table. And this is a incredible table, because at this table we are welcome, whether we are standing proud or whether we are hunched over in grief. We are all welcome to this table at any stage of life or any presence that we offer. God invites us to come exactly as we are. And so we remember on the night that Jesus was betrayed, that he took the bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Eat this in remembrance of me." In a similar fashion, later on in the meal, he took the cup, he gave thanks again, and he said, "This is my blood, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins, for you and for all that will come after you, and all through time. Drink this in remembrance of me." And so it's through the mystery of this meal that we trust God's Spirit is raining down into us, that we are invited to come exactly as we are and receive the grace that God gives. All are welcome at this table. You do not need to have any precursors or be any certain way. You are all welcome to come. There will be two lines that will form down the middle here, and in just a moment, I'll invite my servers to come up and help. So form two lines down the center, be served, and then walk towards the outside of the aisles here. So kind of like a flow. You see it. Would the servers please come forward?
Thank you.
you broke the bread and blessed the cup. You served a sacrifice of love. Holy, 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 I want to see the glory of all that you are and all that you've done. Jesus, the Lamb of God, oh, what a Savior. You took the altar and made it a table. Nothing can separate what you bring together.
couple of announcements this morning. Next Sunday, please plan to stay after Ignite. That is our next fellowship luncheon. It's going to be a taco bar. I know some of you signed up last week. You can probably still sign up to bring something this week, but please plan to come and attend and enjoy a time of fellowship. And also, the Sunday after that, February 12th, is Music Sunday. Plan to attend that day, as it'll feature a lot of, I don't know, more than usual music and band. I guess I'm part of that. I'm not sure what's happening, but I think it'll be fabulous. So you don't want to miss February 12th. So next two Sundays.
Would you stand for the benediction and reach out and take the hand of someone near you? We're going to touch each other. They probably won't bite. This is Sunday. That's Wednesday. Wednesday we bite. We'll play Simon Says. Simon Says, keep your left hand down and put your right hand over your head. Somebody gave in, right? This is the church. It's how it is. This is what we belong to. We can't do anything without affecting someone else. We are not our own. It's not about us. It's about the God who lives in us and through us, the God we take into the world. Go take that God into the world. Amen.
There's honey in the rock.